It's my proud moment to introduce somebody to whom many of us, the microbiologists of our generation who passed out in 90s and 2000, owe to. Dr. Dilip Mathai is truly our mentor for antimicrobial stewardship program. Relentlessly, he tried from his own hospital, CMC Vellore, to touch upon across the country. He used to go to every major city. He started our Hospital Infection Society of India. He started the FNB ID program. He started the infectious disease units in CMC Vellore and many places of the country as a mentor. And I can remember immensely I was benefited. I used to go to CMC Vellore to learn from him. I used to go, in fact, through him, I got the courage to start the clinical infectious disease unit in Calcutta. Those days, Calcutta didn't have automation in microbiology. I started all the automation in microbiology. I started the diagnostic stewardship. Everything I think was possible because I had his blessing, and I truly owe to him. Like Dr. Dilip Mathai, actually today doesn't require any introduction. He is professor and dean of Apollo Institute of Medical Science, where he is working as a head of medicine, head of adult infectious disease. He has become editor almost all Indian journals pertinent to medicine and infection control or infectious disease. Apart from, he has been the convener of FNBID. He has become member of ANBAI. He is the trainer of the trainers. And in Indian contract, he's the past chairman of ICMR, AMR and AMSP committees. He has got more than 350 publications. That is nothing new. Research, he has done enormous research. He has given many guest lectures, more than 300. He has got many university examinerships, starting from MBBS, MD, DNB Medicine, FNBID, whatnot. Many research. And his area of interest will always remain AMS, AMS, and AMS apart from HIV. So Dr. Dilip Mathai is the man who can actually give you the perspective of Indian scenario. The man who has made it in his hand. The man who has made many soldiers like us. Sir, now it's your turn to tell us, where do we stand? You started in 1993, 94. I know that. I was an MD student that time. So now tell us where as a country we stand. So sir will talk about antimicrobial stewardship. As a country, where do we stand? Over to Professor Dilip Mathai.
Thank you, Dr. Shankar. Can you hear me now? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much for this opportunity. And Shankarji, with that presentation, you made me sound like I'm a museum piece. I'm so old or something. You know. Thank you so much for those very kind words. But nevertheless, I'm very happy to be here. And may I also say that we have listened to a wonderful talk over the last 2.5 hours, and I don't think I need to repeat any of those. And I thought I would have a different perspective. And I like this topic, where do we stand as a country? Okay, now I've got 20 minutes, and I've just jotted down five areas that I wish to touch upon so that it becomes a little more easy for us to understand. And as I look at it, yes, why AMSP? We listen to the problem is basically because we've got the world's highest rates of antimicrobial resistance, and we are also the largest consumer of antibiotics in the current decade as such. I want you to understand why this has occurred. And I personally think it's because of the Indian health system that we have. We've got the government sector, we've got the private sector, we've got the unregulated sector. And I didn't really need to update this slide because it is the same. This has been happening over the last 10, 15 years and nothing has changed. And we also should like to understand that private expenditure on health is very high. so-called OOPs, out-of-pocket expenses, very high in our people. And we need to understand the antimicrobial stewardship practice in the hospital in under all these conditions. When I was the chair of the ICMR antimicrobial stewardship program, as well as that of the antimicrobial resistance, we did a study, 20 healthcare institutions, and written documents were available only with 40% of the written in the, with 40% of them had AMSP. And the AMSP, the antimicrobial usage data were analyzed only by 25%. And people collect the data, but they don't analyze it. They don't have an antimicrobial stewardship program in a study done in 2013. And we also found that private hospitals perform better than government healthcare institutions. I wonder why. I think it is because of the accreditation of the public health of the private hospitals as such. And they've got good diagnostic laboratories compared to the government hospitals. And of course, I don't know of any infectious disease physicians working in a government hospital right now. And I don't really know if clinical pharmacists are really available in most of these government hospitals. Of course, they've got pharmacists to dispense the drugs. So you see, it is very rudimentary. It was very rudimentary in 2013. Now, most recent publication by Dr. Bhattacharya et al, 150 centers and questionnaires, 25 responded, 15 have AMSP. And you see, 13 conduct CME, 12 perform routine prescription audits. This is what is happening. Now, when you have a questionnaire-based study, 150 centers and only 25, in classical parlance, it is not a good study. But what could he do? Only 25 people responded. I'm sure he would have asked them to, provide data, but it's not been happening. So if I don't have data, I can assume that if I don't want to expose my nakedness, so I don't want to respond to him. So this is the situation that is happening in India. And you look at it, you've got clinical microbiologists and only 6% of them are ID physicians. I agree with you, there are only a handful of ID physicians, maybe 40, 50, 100, maybe 150 interested in ID, etc. Intensivists are also the same, numbers, because they have lesser beds than the ID physicians have in terms of the consultation practice. And you would see, then what are these 40%? Okay, and who are the other 40% others? So I really don't know who else is general medicine physicians. I am a general medicine physician when I got into infectious disease, but I'm saying not many people in the general medicine field are also interested in infectious disease. I would say intensive care specialists are more interested in infectious disease. On hemato-oncologists, yes, and perhaps some of the cancer therapists, yes, and perhaps some of the all the transplant in the transplant situations, I think they handle a little bit of infectious disease. Having said this, when we recently did a study, practice of AMSP sepsis, and it is being presented in the, I don't want to reveal any data because it's being presented in the critical care meeting that is to happen shortly. And we asked for their AMSP details. The 25 centers, 45 centers, and only 28 provided me AMSP details. But we can still ask for those details and see whether they've updated them. So these are premier institutions in the country that I have looked at. Now, they have a high sepsis burden. I don't want to reveal the data, but they don't have an antimicrobial stewardship program. Now, are they linked? I've not analyzed it as yet. But anyway, I just want to summarize by saying that we have this dual problem of AMR and AMSP. Now, my talk is about AMSP. Now, if you look at it, education is the cornerstone of AMSP. I just listened to a lot of lectures, good lectures, but has it transformed me? Yes, I got a few points that will help transform me. Now, please remember, medical education is to try and create a habit of thinking in the people who listen, or my students who listen, or my PGs who listen, that creating a habit of thinking is what is most important. In order for me to create a habit of thinking in somebody, he or she must be motivated. If the person is not motivated, you cannot do anything. Now, why am I sitting here? I am motivated because I like infectious disease. I like AMR, and I like listening to talks about AMR and AMSP in order for me to upgrade my own personal knowledge. Now, you remember, now if you see all the people who are listening, I know most of them by name as that, and they are microbiologists, some are clinicians, and predominant few ID physicians, but I'm not able to recognize any pharmacologists or pharmacists, maybe So you see now, these are the key players in AMSP. So I'm taking the problem as, I happen to be a dean, I'm a practicing physician, but mainly a dean of two medical colleges in the country, both by oversight and by direct hands-on care. You look at the classes on antibiotics, okay? 534 medical colleges, maybe four or six have infectious disease as a specialty. And antibiotic classes, we have got theory classes, 5 hours in microbiology, and 20 hours in pharmacology, and a clinical topic of 1 hour. Now you look at the theory classes for second professional years. I've got AST in microbiology, antimicrobial resistance, AST, simple stain. I've got 18 theory classes only for pharmacology, okay? Now look at the, you know, the number of drugs. If I have to really count out these drugs, I will tell you it is about 156, perhaps more. Now you see antimicrobial classes that are available. I'm talking, the previous one was theory class. Now we're talking about antimicrobial classes. We don't have sufficient theory classes to cover the 20 antimicrobial classes in the MBBS program. So you see the problem that lies fundamentally in the failure of any AMSP that we're doing in this country is the lack of medical education in terms of the time that is provided for the medical students. And so each class is 45 minutes duration, no emphasis on AMSP. So it's like every morning you go out, what tie shall I wear today? What shoe shall I wear today? What colors of the, what antibiotics shall I use today? So this is what is happening. Now you look at, now in Chittoor in Andhra Pradesh, I have on a PPP model, 850 beds, and I have no control over the antibiotics that they can possibly use. My hospital in the Hyderabad, 500 beds, I have some control. I have, not only because I happen to be dean, but my colleagues are very understanding. And therefore I could do some antimicrobial stewardship practice. Now you look at MCI or National Medical Commission. How many of us are really writing antibiotics in the generic name or in the brand name? I can show you all the prescriptions as brand name. It is, of course, illegal, but you can't do anything. What can the MCI do? MCI can come and cancel the license of a doctor, no way. Because he or she does not, it has to be, the habit has to change. And I am in the medical field 42 years, and I have still never written a drug, at least antibiotics, antimicrobial agents, or any antihypertensives or any other drug in its brand name. The only time I used to write chloramphenicol or chlorum is within brackets, Park Davis, those days, other chloromycin. Otherwise, I don't write. So you have to get into the habit of writing generic, then you will think more. And brand names, also the problem with brand names, I don't want to get into this. Now for the national boards, we have got 22 programs under the DNB, the RNB. And now they've started the diplomate in the international board. If you recall, we had this 2-year DA program, 2-year ENT program, 2-year ophthal program, has been removed from the MCI and has now gone into the national board degree. Now, how many, now this DA can be done in 100 bedded hospital. Anybody with 100 beds can apply for any of these diploma programs. Okay, you need 2 faculty, one with a plus 8 years of experience and another one with 5 years of experience. Now the teachers are a dying brand. If I'm in a private hospital, I would spend more time seeing patients and less time only providing some kind of an information to the student who is by my side. The transfer of learning must be there must be hand holding, otherwise the transfer of learning will not happen. So in a medical college we are able to do that, but if a committed teacher in a private setup, they should be able to teach them antimicrobial use as such. And we're talking today only about antibiotics and not really about the antifungal, the antiviral, the ATT, all that happened. So you see, the problem, it lies in the training of the Indian medical graduate. Now you look at this. Education is considered to be the essential element. What is education? And the knowledge I can transfer, but the process of learning as it understood. Today, most of the medical students are now interested in the postgraduate seats or in the exit exam or getting out of the system. So what are they looking at? Comprehension, speed, accuracy, facts, content, not really understanding the actual usage. There is no case studies for them. It's just answer. So that is the problem that we are now facing. I think the key to improving the antibiotic stewardship in our country is to improve the education. Now we talk about training competencies. Now you're a microbiologist, I'm a physician. I worked in microbiology for 3 years, but what is the difference? My training competency, if I say that I am a far better clinician than a microbiologist, but I have the knowledge of microbiology, is that our training is different. Our thinking process is different. I've had clinical practice oriented. Now subject of medicine, you study forwards. Microbiology also, you study forwards. But the practice of medicine is to see the problem and then come to the diagnosis. It's backwards. This is the fundamental thing about clinical practice oriented service. If you see the patient eyeball to eyeball. So what happens is the thinking process is different. You do forward learning, but the practice is backward. So this is one of the reasons why antimicrobial stewardship or the antimicrobial prescribing habits are changing or are not changing. And everybody just writes an antibiotic. Microbiologists are most research oriented. They are excellent in epidemiology, public health and hygiene. They have a practical training. They are skilled at bench side. Now, when I look at it, clinical ID specialists can evaluate non-infectious causes, microbiologists, causative organisms. Pathophysiological concepts are better with the clinical ID specialist. Clinical localization of the problem, urinary tract infection, upper, lower, urinary tract. And we may know a little more about PK/PD, but the molecular mechanisms and the MIC and AST are better learned by the microbiologists. So how do these two meet? If these two do not meet, if these do not see eye to eye, if these two do not communicate well or learn from each other, you are never going to solve this problem of this antimicrobial stewardship program in our country. Now we started this antibiotic. This is one of those sessions that we first started in 2008. So the students are learning how to use antibiotics only after graduating and commencing practice. They have not learned it well. They didn't have time, not even in the postgraduate. In the three-year program, you just observed what antibiotics the physicians were using, who have not had experience in the AMSP program as such. This was AMSP research. Chandi did this study in CMC Vellore, and Balaji was also part of it. They looked at it. What is the research? And see, we do not have education based upon research. You look at in our country, what is the publication of AMSP? I talk a lot, what is the publication of AMSP? Prevention of infection and control, we are excellent at picking up epidemics. So you see now, very little, you're 20 times, 30 times less than the West in terms of the publications for AMSP. Now, yes, what is the current status now? Yes, we had the part of the Chennai Declaration. How much did we move? Yes, Ministry of Health has discussed. Many groups have come into it. And then, now, what is the current status? ICMR has developed antibiotic policy guidelines, monitors antibiotic prescription at community levels, pharmacy, private clinics. We have got infection control. We've got a policy manual, NABH, etc. But having said this, okay, they've got the National Action Plan on Antimicrobial Resistance. States have got the National Action Plan on Antimicrobial Resistance. Kerala state is best. Telangana is poor. I don't know which other state is better. Telangana recently started for neonatal sepsis. To understand, we don't have, I have no clueless about what organism causes neonatal sepsis. Outbound, inborn neonates, yet we all treat them with antibiotics. It's a guess. Now, these treatment guidelines have been brought up by us. But how many of us really read the book after we have the treatment guidelines? At least we've got Indian publications with some Indian data to understand what is the treatment guidelines for the common syndromes that we see. Now, Sujit Chandy and others at Valor, they have started a prescribing antimicrobial rationally for common conditions with the ICMR. It's good, but people have taken up this course, but it needs updating. It needs updating. Things change. If you look at the chapter on acute febrile illness, scrub typhus is azithromycin, typhoid is azithromycin, leptospirosis is azithromycin. So when somebody came and asked, sir, if I have a patient with fever with acute undifferentiated fever, it works on these three, why not I start on azithromycin? See how they think tangentially. See, this is the problem. Now, the current status, MCI and National Book, the National Medical Commission booklet of 2019 very clearly shows that describe and discuss the rational use of antimicrobials, including antibiotic stewardship program. And I have only 25 hours. The competency is not evaluated. 25 hours, how can I do that? What does my IMA do? IMA will just give a notice in the newspaper which says we should not give antibiotics for fever, cold. They have to have bring out publications. Can you say that the IMA, I was past president of the IMA local chapter. Can you bring out and tell community, there are 6,14,000 doctors in the country. Only 161 is registered in the IMA. So 161,000 is registered in the IMA. We have to change the practice there. I recently now purchased this fifth edition of NABH. Good, there are some changes from the fourth edition. Good, we're applying for our NABH recognition. We've got the updated version of our program. The Department of Microbiology has prepared it. But you look at the NABH booklet on rational use of antibiotics. The core is there. Monitoring is the core. But the actual implementation is only excellence. I can get my NABH accreditation with excellence. Okay, but we really need to understand that it should become the core. If that is not the core, then NABH accredited hospitals, what is the value? So you have to look at it. I know that you're seeing a speaker after me, but I wanted to provocate him, so I have shown this slide. Now you look at the current status AMSP in the NABH. This is the on medications. They nothing. See, you see, everything is written out. Medications are dispensed in safe manner, written in a uniform manner, are prescribed safely, etc. Now, of course, they are written in the that about the prescription audit, but we still have to see how we implement this. So, in conclusion, I just want to end with four slides, which tells and giving you some challenges. Now, who is handling? Who is monitoring? Who is supervising antibiotic use in the outpatient setting? Who is, now I can understand prophylactic antibiotics being managed by surgeons. Now identify high priority conditions. What is the high priority conditions? And maybe indicated, I'll just give you one example. Now, antibiotic bronchitis in the United States, you don't give an antibiotic. In India, gale mein kich kich, a little bit of a cough, you give an antibiotic. Now, we don't need to give antibiotics for a bronchitis. Now, what is bronchitis? And just next to it is the lung parenchyma, which is pneumonia. Now, who auscultates? Nobody does a complete. You just heard people say, they'll have a complete thorough physical examination. As a dean, let me tell you, does not exist. You have to insist that you have to feel the pulse of a person and then examine the chest before you make a diagnosis of bronchitis or a pneumonia. The problem is not making a diagnosis, an anatomical diagnosis or a physiological diagnosis or a pathological diagnosis, what we call it as pathophysiological diagnosis, and then you write the etiology. It is not happening, partly because of the pressure, the number of patients that they are seeing eyeball to eyeball. Now you look at communicable disease, acute undifferentiated fever. In infectious disease, fever is the most common. Now, cases of acute diarrhea, I still teach you don't need any drugs or any antibiotics for diarrhea. I still teach you don't need any antibiotics for fever. But let me also tell you, that is in the number one community acquired bacteria producing fever is Salmonella typhi. And let me tell you, there is no physician in the whole wide world who can make a diagnosis of Salmonella typhi on day zero or day one, day two, day three, day four, day five. Perhaps day six or five and a half, they can feel a spleen and see the nature of the illness, step ladder pattern being established. Maybe it is typhoid. Now tell me, who does blood culture from the community for us to understand what is the susceptibility pattern? But anyway, they start the treatment. So you see, we handle a different problem in the community. Now you look at prescription audit, leadership. Yes, we have leaderships. There, everybody is interested. Nobody says don't practice AMS. Nobody says that. And then, now when we're collecting an antibiogram developed without significant clinical history, will not be sufficient. You have to understand where this urinary isolate or why the clinician has sent this. We should be disease oriented or disorder oriented for us to understand or create an empirical antimicrobial antibiotic guidelines. Hospital antibiogram. If my hospital has less than 100 organisms, where is the question of MIC 50 or 90? In 30 months, I get only this many organisms and I rely only on blood culture. So you see, it's very difficult for the smaller hospitals to develop an antibiogram. It is expensive. And you should all understand that it's easy said and done, follow what the antibiogram says. I tell people, microbiologists will tell me only what they grow. But what we clinicians need to know is what they don't grow. If I don't know if nobody tells me what they are growing, then what do? I go for an empirical therapy and choose the best because I'm seeing the patient eyeball to eyeball. Yes, when the patient is sick, nobody tells you don't use this antibiotic. But the patient does not have any major illness and you know fully well that this patient is unlikely to go under. We take a chance, we hold on, watch. When I say watch, you have to watch them every 8 hours. If you don't watch them every 8 hours, you don't know when sepsis or septic shock syndrome can set in. It's not today morning 8 o'clock I do rounds, next morning 8 o'clock I do rounds and watch for sepsis, because the greatest worry in a fever is, will this patient go into a sepsis or septic shock? So you understand the feeling, the worry and the concerns. So how do I teach my medical students? How do I educate them? Don't give them enough knowledge about antimicrobial agents. We don't give them enough situations of antimicrobial, where you can manage without antibiotics. The clinicians have to teach. Microbiologists have to assist. Now, what about fungal? What about viral? We're really going to have a problem if we do not have the concept of the principles of antimicrobial stewardship. I just wrote an article for my college magazine, The Meeting of the Minds, the four ends, national education policy, which has come out during this pandemic. You've got the Niti Aayog, you've got the National Medical Commission, and you've got the NBE. Everybody has to meet and put antimicrobial AMSP as their top priority if you really want to beat this antimicrobial resistance issue. Now you look at this problem. Now we come at Ayurveda College and 100 UG MBBS College. The difference is not much, or the difference is substantial, however you look at. Now, what are we to do now? You think the Ayurveda physicians are not going to use antimicrobial agents? You have no way to prevent it. Now, who is the biggest competitor in life for an MBBS doctor? When I send my graduate out, who is your competitor? I tell them it is the Ayush group. you will learn your communications better. I don't want you to learn your antibiotics better. Don't learn how to use it, but not how to misuse it. But learn communication skill. Ayurveda College, excellent in communication, low cost. And most of the fevers respond, as you know, 99% or 98% will respond without any great antibiotics. So this is what I wish to conclude. And you will find, if you are, I really do not know what is the roadmap for improving AMSP in India. Everybody has to cooperate, the microbiologists, the physicians, the pharmacists, the student teaching, and we bring out better and better students with understanding this. And thank you very much for the listening. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your excellent deliberation. Like always, you have mesmerized us. You have made some eye-opener facts in front of us. We have ignited again the age-old debate, genetic versus brand. Your view on should the ID course be again open for microbiology doctors, MD microbiology?
Very personally, I am for to open up. But I'm telling you, the training is, if the microbiology, I don't want to get into any controversy. Today, everybody is in love with me, but I don't want to get into controversy. But what I'm saying is, if the microbiologist can spend 3 years in clinical medicine, yes. Because the practice is different. Yes, I don't know. That is the
problem. Now, I also don't want to go into the controversy. In the MBA microbiology forum, now I am there. By virtue of that, I have already told them to start DNB infectious disease 3 years, where the MD microbiology people will be given the opportunity. I don't know what.
I'll write it up. You send me a letter, please.
I have already given the suggestion to Professor.
Have the microbiologist write to National Board. The copy will be forwarded to me, and then I will take it up. My meeting is next week.
Okay, sir. Thank you.